Romans chapter 13, that is Romans chapter 13, we're going to pick up this week in verse 8. We were able to get through verse 7, and now we're going to pick up in verse 8 and finish out this chapter here, chapter 13. And it says in verse 8, do not owe anyone anything except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. The commandments, do not commit adultery, do not murder, do not steal, do not covet. And if there's any other commandment, all are summed up by this. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Love, therefore, is the fulfillment of the law. Besides this, knowing the time, it is already the hour for you to wake up from the sleep. For now our salvation is nearer than when we first believed. The night is nearly over and the daylight is near, so let us discard the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us walk with decency as in the daylight, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual impurity and promiscuity, not in quarreling and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no plans to satisfy the fleshly desires. Let's pray. God, this is your word. Open it up to us, even at this moment, Lord. Let the Holy Spirit fall among us, move in us and through us and to us. Anoint me for this task that I'm not capable. Lord, we ask that you clearly reveal your word to us this morning. In Jesus' name. Now the apostle has been discussing the laws which govern the various relationships of the Christian's life. Last week we looked how God has established our governments and how we're to respond to those governments. How a believer, how a Christian is to act with the government that God has placed above him. Paul now turns his attention to the highest law of all, the law of love, and he displays how love rules supreme in the believer's heart, and it legislates for every situation of our lives. Now the Apostle Paul begins this section of the epistle by speaking of love's moral conscience. Love makes the conscience of an individual far more tender than the law can ever do. Now in verses 8 through 10, Paul reminds his readers that the commandments, or he reminds his readers of the commandments of the Lord. Now the believer keeps the commandments not because they are commandments of the law, but because they are commandments of our Lord. Love for the Lord, for our Lord, accomplishes what fear of the law could never, ever accomplish. In John 14, 21, Jesus says, the one who has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. Now there are three facets of this which are all embracing. The one who has Christ's commands and keeps them is the one who loves Christ. So the opposite must be true. The one who has Christ's commands and does not keep them does not love Christ. Do we understand that? Do we see that? That's what it's saying. I mean, you've got to be able to take the opposite here and say, okay, if I have his commands and I love him, I'm going to keep them. If I have his commands and I don't love him, then I won't keep his commands. There are three facets of this which are all embracing. Verse 8 speaks to love's debt. Love's debt is magnormous. I know that's probably not a word, but I like it anyway. It sounds good. Magnormous. Love's debt is magnormous. In verse 8, Paul says, do not owe anyone anything except to love one another. For the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. Love will always have the interest of the creditor in view. Now, this is not a precept of to outlaw a believer from entering into a contractual agreement whereby he obtains a properly bonded loan. This is not necessarily saying that we cannot borrow money. This does, however, forbid a believer from borrowing money beyond his ability to repay what he has borrowed. Now today, it is very easy for the average American to borrow as much money as he wants, even to the point that he grows in debt to a level that it's not possible to repay that debt. The believer is to avoid this kind of thing. It is just as dishonest to go down and rob the local bank as it is for a Christian to borrow more money than he can repay and then keep his creditors waiting. Nothing will ruin your Christian testimony faster than crime, indebtedness. Love should touch a Christian's conscience and make him or her eager to live beyond reproach in this matter of his or her finances. Now the story of Zacchaeus illustrates this to be so. No sooner had this dishonest tax collector come face to face with his Lord and his Savior Jesus Christ than he exclaimed, "Look, I'll give half of my possessions to the poor. Lord, and if I have extorted anything from anyone, I'll pay back four times as much." And Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house." Zacchaeus was not saved because he wanted to get his financial affairs in order. He wanted to get his financial affairs in order because he was saved. He wanted to put his financial affairs in order because God had got a hold of his life and transformed his life. Zacchaeus' personal contact with the Lord Jesus Christ won his heart and quickened his moral conscience. Do you see that? Because the Lord and Savior came to Zacchaeus, and he sees who Zacchaeus sees who he is, and he believes upon Jesus Christ. All of a sudden, Zacchaeus realizes, what did the Lord teach? What does he teach? What does the Word teach? And he wants to be obedient to what God's Word teaches. And he quickly says, "If I have cheated anyone, I'll pay them back four times." And he was going to give half of what he had to those that were poor. Someone that loves others like they love themselves wants to give what they have to others. And you see, Zacchaeus had a real encounter with his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Do not owe anyone anything. Now this principle goes beyond the interest of a creditor and embraces every obligation. And we have obligations outside of financial obligations. Any pledge, any promise should be kept without our hesitation, no matter how difficult it might be to keep. Please understand that also. That when you tell someone you're going to do something, you must be about what you said you were going to do. And it's not, "Well, I've got my fingers behind my back and I crossed them." That does not work with God. Do we understand that? When you say something to someone, whether you say, "I pledge it" or "I promise it," that is your word, your very word. Now, Corey kind of gets on to me sometimes, and I laughed about it this morning as I was talking to her about that. I mentioned that I was going to bring this up. She doesn't like me to use her name in the sermons, but she was okay with this one, when me use this illustration. But I sometimes will not commit to anything. And it's funny, somebody will be talking to me and say, "Well, can you do this?" Well, I will try to do that. I will make my best effort. But always remembering, understanding, that if we vow something, if we tell someone we're going to do something, you better do it.